You want me to identify myself?
Yeah, I'm just
brief. Okay, I'm Howard Zinn, and I've been teaching for years at Boston University. And before that, I taught at Spelman College in Atlanta, Georgia, small black women's college. I'm a historian, sort of. That is, I was trained in history at NYU, graduate work at Columbia, et cetera. And I've written a bunch of books on history, including a book called People's History of the United States. I suppose I come to this question of communism and anti-communism from several vantage points. One, when I was growing up in the slums of New York, which is where I grew up, in a working class family, which had a hard time making a living, and which therefore led me at the age of 18 not to go to college, but to go to work in a shipyard for 3 years, and that was the start of my professional career as a shipyard worker. And when I heard the word communist, a communist was somebody. I didn't know what a communist was, except that it was bad, radical, wild, crazy, etc. However, about the time I was 17 or so, I ran into, or they ran into me, a couple of communist guys who lived on my block. And what impressed me was that they knew a lot about what was going on in the world. They knew what was going on in Mexico. They knew what was going on. They knew about fascism. They knew about Mussolini and Hitler. And I began reading. And I was impressed with the fact that they were very sincere and dedicated people who cared about what was going on in the world. They weren't only interested in sports, which I was interested in. They were interested in what was happening to people in Germany, what was happening to people in Spain. And that kind of concern really impressed me. Once they asked me to go to a demonstration in Times Square, and I didn't know what it was about, but I went along, because I'd never been to a demonstration, and I'd rarely been to Times Square even, even though I lived in New York, it was exciting. I went to this big demonstration, and there were all these people walking down through Times Square with signs, and I thought, well, that's nice. It's very American. That was the American I thought about, yeah, freedom of expression, etc. They were communists, I guessed, you know. Can you tell a communist by looking at them? Carrying a picket sign, they must be a communist. So soon I found myself carrying a sign. Somebody handed me a sign. To this day, I don't know what it was, except I think it was anti-war or something. Then I heard sirens. And I thought, there must be a fire somewhere around. And then I saw police on horseback galloping through the crowd, swinging their clubs. And I didn't believe it. You see, I thought, this is the picture of Tsarist Russia, the Cossacks, you know, racing through, you know. This was America. And these people weren't doing anything. They weren't even blocking traffic. They were just walking along carrying signs. And here were the police ordered out to break their heads and break up their demonstration in the land of free speech and the Bill of Rights and the First Amendment. And why? Because they were communists. And what it said to me was several things at once, and that is anti-communism is just as anti-communist. It seems to be against anybody who demonstrates against something, you know, that the establishment stands for. Anybody who steps out of line, anybody who says something different, taught me something else, that something my communist friends had been saying to me, which I didn't quite believe, turned out to be true. And that is, they had said, you know, the government is not neutral. Because I've been brought up and I learned this in civics and so on, right? Yes, sure, there are rich and there are poor, and there's capital and there's labor. There are different interests in this country, but the government is neutral. The government mediates among these, you know, balance of powers, checks and balances, all of that stuff I learned in school. The government is neutral. My friends had said, these communist guys had said, government is not neutral. Government is on the side of the rich. Government is on the side of the powerful. If there's a labor dispute, the government is going to be on the side of management, you know. And if somebody is protesting, the government is going to be a side on it. The police are going to be against the protesters. And so there it was. When they said the Bill of Rights, yeah, sure, we have the Bill of Rights, but actually it doesn't exist for certain groups of people. It doesn't exist for blacks. It doesn't exist for minorities of various kinds. It doesn't exist for radicals. It doesn't exist for communists. Well, that, my experience that night, I should add one little thing, which was not a little thing. And that is, while I was carrying this sign, at a certain point, I was spun around, and all I saw was a big form of a plainclothesman, and I was hit on the side of the head and knocked out. I woke up in the hallway. I was unconscious. I woke up in a hallway. I don't know how much later. I looked around. Times Square was back to where it was before the demonstration started. I saw no one around. My friends weren't around, no demonstration, no police. It was a weird, spooky feeling. But when I woke up, I woke up with these realizations that I'm just talking about. It made me think, you know, about what is all this about communism? When I went to work in the shipyard at the age of 18, I had time to read at night. And I began to read Marx and Engels. I read the Communist Manifesto. Communist Manifesto, wow. You know, what does it call for? It made a lot of sense to me. In fact, it was sort of exciting, exhilarating. Because the Communist Manifesto, it put a lot of things into perspective. It said, look, mankind has gone through a whole series of stages. You know, from living in very primitive societies to the feudalism. Now we're living mostly under capitalist society. All these stages are necessary as part of history, and they all contribute something. And capitalism contributes something as capitalism develops the technology, machines, electricity, et cetera, to a very high point. Well, capitalism is modern society with all of its advances. And it does a good job at that. You know, builds the railroads and steel mills and airplanes and so on. But it does it at the expense of human beings. It does it by people working long hours, 12, 16 hours a day. It does it at terrific human expense. It does it by the rich capitalist nations exploiting the poor, darker peoples, Africa, Asia, you know, controlling them, imperialism and so on. And also, it does it at the expense of wars, continual wars and economic crises. It all made sense. It all fitted into what I was seeing. It seemed all true to me. And when Marx talked about, well, history moves on. Capitalism will have to move on. The working people, the people who are not doing well under the system, are someday going to rise up and overthrow the system. And they're going to change it, and they're going to set up a system where people will share things more equally. And where people won't be exploited, and we won't have national boundaries, and we'll have an international society, and everybody will be brothers and sisters, and someday you won't even have a government. Well, you'll have administrators, you'll have a social security system, or a health system, or traffic cops take care of, you know, this problem or that problem, but you won't have police and courts and states and jails and armies. You won't need them, because people will have the basic necessities, and when people have the basic necessities, they don't need to do those things. Oh, that sounded really good to me. Really, it impressed me. And you might say I was, from that point on in my head, a communist with a small c. I didn't, that is, let's understand the difference. A communist with a small c is somebody who believes in the idea of communism. A communist with a big C is a guy or a woman who's a member of a communist movement, you see. But I enlisted in the Air Force after being in the shipyard. And in the Air Force, I kept reading. And this was in World War II. I was a bombardier in the Air Force in World War II. And in fact, as part of my political consciousness, which developed as a result of meeting these communists, I was very conscious of fascism. One of the things that was impressive about the communists is they were the first ones, really, the most fearless ones to fight fascism. They went over and volunteered to fight in Spain against fascism. They risked their lives. They weren't drafted. and then half of them died there. That was very impressive. These are self-sacrificing people. When I worked in the shipyard, I was aware that communists were organizing workers. And I began to read labor history. Communists had organized auto workers. Communists had helped organize the CIO. They'd done a lot of good things. During the Depression, communists had organized the unemployed. They'd organized tenants. They'd done a lot of really good things. I wasn't thinking about the Soviet Union. I wasn't thinking about these, you know, Stalin. I wasn't really, that Soviet Union. They call themselves communist or Marxist or socialist, whatever, but I really didn't know much about what was going on over there. And when the communists said, well, it's a great place over there, I didn't really go into it. When I came out, but during the war, while I was flying missions, bombing missions, some guy I was talking to, a guy on another crew, who was also very interested in politics as I was and read a lot as I did, gave me books to read, which suggested to me that the Soviet Union was not all that it was cracked up to be, at least not by my communist friends, and that made me think twice about what was going on in the Soviet Union. And after the war, even though I continued being sympathetic to actually the idea of communism and socialism I became more and more, the Soviet Union didn't interest me that much, you see, but when I found out about it, I didn't like what it was doing. Sure, they introduced health care and they did a lot of reforms and they did a lot of things for the Russian people that had never been true under Tsarism and so on, but a lot of ugly things began to appear. And then, I'm rushing now down to the present day, to my present thinking, because I don't want to take you day by day through my life. Right? But it seems to me it is very important to understand that the word communism is such a complicated word, that it means so many things. And then when people are anti-communist, when workers are anti-communist, Americans are anti-communist, when they get indignant, when they get hatred in their eyes at the word communist, it's because I think it's not because they're against socialized medicine or against people sharing things or against a better distribution of wealth. It's because they're thinking communist, Stalin, the Soviet Union, firing squads, you know, the secret police, the pulling people out of the houses in the middle, thinking communism represents that, you see, something that the Soviet Union has done in the name of communism, which is not good, which does not meet the vision of a free society that I think Marx really had, the society that communism should be. So communism means that, but also to other people it means that original dream of an international society, no differentiation between sex and race, no very rich and very poor. Oh, not that everybody will be exactly equal. This is one of the caricatures of communism. What? Everybody will be exactly equal? It'll be so boring, you know? Of course, that's not the point. The point is that, you know, when 1% of the American population owns a huge proportion of the wealth of the United States and 30 million people are really, really poor, and all you have to do is walk into any city in the United States, and you see that Marx is right. There's a class system. There are rich, there are poor. And that original dream that we have to do away with such a class system. Rich and poor in American cities, rich and poor in the world, rich Americans and poor people in Africa and Asia, rich in North America and poor in Guatemala and Nicaragua and Honduras, countries that we have had relations with for years and we've done nothing to alleviate their poverty, in fact, to make it worse and to control them. So, I think that word communism has to be understood in its all its complexity, and you have to separate the parts that represent something bad, you know, Soviet, secret police, Stalinism, parts that, now even Gorbachev, even before him, Khrushchev for a while, right, put aside and said, no, we did that, that was wrong. Have to separate those parts from that original idea, which I think is still a good idea, which we still need. I mean, look at the world today. The world of people fighting wars. They're supposed to be small wars. The war in Iran, Iraq, 1 million people die. The war in Southeast Asia, a small war, 2 million people, 3 million people die. The war in Korea, a small war, 2 million people die. A world of nations divided and fighting one another. I mean, that international spirit of the original idea of socialism, we need that very badly today. We need to do something about the distribution of wealth. Now, our problem is to have the good things about socialism and communism along with freedom of speech and civil liberties and no secret police and no, you know, none of the ugly things that both capitalism and socialism have that governments do to people. You know, I guess there are two things I'd like to say about the way the word communism has been used in the United States, you see. And the one is that what it loses sight of is that radicals in American history, and by radicals I mean, they've been communists, they've been socialists, they've been anarchists, they've been all sorts of people who want things changed, who've been indignant at the way things are going. And these radicals, these anarchists, these socialists, these communists, without them, we would not have had the kind of changes that took place in this country, which were good changes. Because very often these people, these agitators, these radicals, they were the ones who were needed to start things off. They didn't do it all by themselves. But for instance, in 1886, there was a movement in the United States for the 8-hour day. Now that movement was propelled and given force by anarchists. And they were organizers and stimulators and provokers. And in fact, as a result of their activities, they were put in jail and some of them were executed on some phony charge because some bomb was thrown in Chicago, the Haymarket Affair, in the ranks of policemen. The policemen died. They never found out who threw the bomb, but they just, who are we going to arrest? We're going to arrest 8 anarchists, and we're going to hang 4 of them, you see. But the 8-hour movement, which the anarchists had been so important in, that grew. It was a powerful demand, and it worked. I mean, the reason we have an basic eight-hour day is because people struggled for it, and radicals were among those who were the first to struggle for it. And the socialists at the turn of the century, who fought for changes in the system of work, who fought for higher wages, and who fought against World War I, and who raised the idea of why should we go to fight in foreign wars for whom, for what, for the profit of the munitions makers, we're not really fighting for democracy, and etc., and people are getting killed. The socialists raised that question in World War I. They were very important. They made a lot of Americans think about war. A lot of the literature that came out after the war where people said, they told us it was a war to end all wars. Obviously, it wasn't. A war for democracy, it wasn't. 10 million people are dead, and so on. Well, the radicals had played an important part in that, developing that anti-war feeling. And in the 1930s, it was the communists in the labor movement who played an important part. Well, I mentioned that before. All the struggles of the 1930s, yes.
You just have to change the tape, so before you go on to that.
Yeah, okay. I'll wrap this up very fast. But so I think of the role that radicals have played, important role. You need radicals. Radicals may be wrong at times. They may go overboard at times. They may get excessive at times, but you absolutely need them, because without radicals, you'll have Dukakis and Bush. You'll have the Republicans and the Democrats. You'll have these people saying the same things the same, keeping $300 billion a year for arms every year, no matter whether they're Republicans or Democrats. You need radicals to stimulate thought, to go outside the boundaries of thinking, and to lead and organize and provoke us. Very important.